As I welcome the Holy Spirit, I also welcome each and every one of you. I thank you for your patience, and I thank y'all for your lives. And as promised, we are going to be speaking about discerning of spirits and how to learn if the spirit that is speaking to us through a person is indeed the Holy Spirit, or if it's a spirit that has been permitted to speak truth, all right, or instructed to speak truth, allowed to speak truth, or if it is a spirit that manifests in multiple ways, and one of the ways that it prefers to manifest, or one of the spirits, is just one that speaks the word of God, because this can happen. Another thing that we may examine in that I think should be mentioned is that there can be a person who is filled with the Holy Spirit, but Satan may be speaking through them at that time. A case or an example would be with Peter, who one moment he was saying, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living Yah." And the Messiah said, "Flesh and blood has not revealed that to you, but my Father, which is in heaven, has revealed that to you." And how did he reveal it to him? By his Spirit. All right, so let's into this. I appreciate each and every one of you, and I truly, truly thank y'all for your lives. I do want you to know that whenever you announce that you are going to be speaking on this sort of subject, you can anticipate demonic activity. You can anticipate, even if, for lack of a better word, predict that there will be some stirring in the spirit, and I have witnessed all of those, okay? And I thank Yah that I have victory over it all, through it all, no matter what challenges come up. We have victory in Christ Yeshua. Now, I have recorded this before. I did record this before, but it was only 15 minutes, and I wanted to make sure that I'm flowing in Christ and moving at His pace. I did mention that I may do several parts of this share and other shares. We'll see how it comes out, but right now we can flow as long as He wants, okay? And that's what we're going to do, because I did go ahead and upgrade the software. So we're going to start, I think it's very important for us to start in Romans chapter 8, okay? Because what I want to accomplish in obedience to Christ is to make sure that those who need to hear this will hear it and receive it, even if they are already poised to reject it, okay? And so I think it's very important for us to know that when the word comes, it does one of three things. It's either going to remind you of something that the Lord has already spoken to you. It's going to correct you where you need to be corrected, or it's going to forewarn you concerning something that you need to be mindful of. You, me, or whoever is hearing the word. I'm first partaker of any word that I present to you. Even if that word does not apply to me in a specific situation, it's either going to do what? Forewarn, remind us of what He's already said to us, or it's going to correct us. The word is not going to return void. If you are listening constantly to the word of Yah and you can never find a place in at least one of those three categories, and there are more, then there is something definitely wrong, because the word is not going to return to Yah void. It's going to accomplish the purpose, even if that purpose is just to forewarn us. All right, so when we hear the word, we should have our heart and our spirit and our mind poised to receive it and not be condemned. All right, if you are convicted, allow it to correct you, but don't be condemned. In fact, if you are born of the Spirit of Christ and you have the mind of Spirit of the Spirit of Christ, you will not be condemned. It says here in Romans chapter 8, "There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit." All right, and let's go down to verse 5. "For they that are of the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are of the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity." That means it's an enemy of God. "For it is not subject to the law of God." Now this is speaking about the law of God. "Neither indeed can be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please Yah." All right? So we here are speaking about the law, and we're speaking about the mind of Christ, the spiritual mind that we have to have. If just the mentioning of this, which I mentioned to you all that I will be speaking on this topic, the mention of this caused demons to stir. If it gets you uncomfortable that somebody's going to be speaking about multiple personality demons or multiple personality evil spirits speaking through people, if you get all nervous and you try to do damage control and all these other stuff, or you try to avoid the subject, that lets me know that you don't have any peace, all right? You're not spiritually minded, because the spiritual mind knows that any word, even if it comes to correct us, it's a word that's going to lead to life and peace. But if your peace is disturbed, that's something that you need to really allow the Holy Spirit to examine you and say, why am I nervous about this? Why is this bothering me? Why would I resist this? What is stealing your peace? It could be that you're carnally minded and not spiritually minded. More than likely, that's what the problem is. All right. So we want to be people who have the mind of the Spirit that leads to life and peace. Let's look at something else in 1 Corinthians. Okay. 1 Corinthians says here, but the natural man receiveth not the things of the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned. But he that is spiritual judgeth all things, yet he himself is judged of no man. For who have known the mind of the Lord that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ. We don't have to worry about the word condemning us or judging us with condemnation. We judge a righteous judgment, but we're not condemned by that judging. We're not condemned by the word. We're not condemned by it. All right. It says here that he's judged of no man. All right. Yah is our judge, but we as children of Yah can judge a righteous judgment. All right. And so when that word comes forth, we should be able to judge righteously, even if it's concerning ourselves. So with that in mind, let's get into this, and let us be poised in the spirit and in the natural to receive the engrafted word of Yah and his truth. And his word is true. 1 John chapter 4. It says, beloved, believe not every spirit. All right. So that's something that we need to be poised to do as we're coming to receive the scripture. Listen to what is being shared. I challenge you to listen to what is being shared. And not only listen, but search the scriptures and see if what I'm sharing is not just a scripture, but if it is the line upon line, precept upon precept, word of the living Yah. Anyone can make a point, but can we go line upon line and lay a solid foundation in truth? In fact, we don't even have to lay truth. Truth is already laid, okay? But what we should be able to do is to pull from the scriptures of Yah and prove the truth that we are standing upon. So the truth that I'm going to show you is that we cannot just judge or determine whether or not someone is speaking by the Spirit of Christ or by an unclean spirit, or Satan is speaking and one of his personalities is to speak the truth. We cannot judge that just because the person confesses Christ, and we're going to see this here. All right. 1 John chapter 4 says, beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesseth that Yeshua Christ is come in the flesh is of God. And every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. All right, let's stop right there. This has been what people have used as their test, their main test, or their only test of determining whether or not someone is born of God, if someone has the Holy Spirit, or if it's the Lord, you know, that's speaking. This may be one of the tests that you use, but it is not the sure enough test on whether or not someone is born of the Spirit of Christ, or if the Holy Spirit dwells in them, or if they're even speaking, if the spirit that's speaking is the Holy Spirit. All right, I'm going to show you this. In fact, this passage is teaching us not so much to determine those things, but to determine whether or not someone is Antichrist or not. Okay, continuing on, it says, and this is that spirit of Antichrist. What is the spirit of Antichrist? Let's go back to verse 3. And every spirit that confesseth not that Yeshua Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of Antichrist, whereof you have heard that it should come, and even now already is in the world. You are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. Greater is he that is in you than who is the he that he's speaking of? He's speaking about those with the spirit of Antichrist, because it says, than he that is in the world. What is in the world? Let's go back up and see what the word says. It says, every spirit that confesseth not that Yeshua Christ is come in the flesh is not of God, and this is that spirit of Antichrist, whereof you have heard that it should come, and even now already is in the world. So this is definitely a way to test the spirit, but which spirit is it to should be used to test? It should be used to test the spirit of Antichrist. For example, Jews, for example, do not confess that Christ has come. All right, they're still waiting for Messiah to come. All right, those who are still waiting on Messiah, not only Jews, but even those who are Torah believers who do not believe in Yeshua as the Son of Yah. They don't even believe that Yah has a son, although it's throughout the Old Testament. They are Antichrist. I know they, you know, fellowship on Sabbath, and they teach out of Torah, and they may appear to be believers in the Most High Yah. They are believers in the Most High Yah, but they're not even believing on him, because the scripture says you can't even believe on the Father if you reject the Son. You can't. You're not believing on the true and the living Yah, because he has testified of his Son. And if you reject that testimony, you have rejected him. No compromise. All right? And so this 1 John chapter 4 can be used as a way, one of the ways that we can test to see if a person has the spirit of Antichrist. So many religious people have the spirit of Antichrist, because they do not believe on Messiah. They do not believe that Yeshua is the Son of the living Yah. All right? But if you make this your test and your standard to determine if someone is born of the Spirit of Christ, or if they're speaking of the Spirit of Christ, and if you say, you know, a person cannot have evil spirits and be born again, then I want to challenge you to continue to look line upon line, precept upon precept, and see if that is true. All right, let's go to Luke chapter 4. All right, so in Luke chapter 4, we're going to start with verse 38. Okay. Luke chapter 4, it says here, and he arose out of the synagogue and entered into Simon's house. Now this is speaking of Christ. All right. And it says here, and Simon's wife's mother, meaning Simon's mother-in-law, was taken with a great fever, and they besought him for her. And he stood over her and rebuked the fever, and it left her, and immediately she arose and ministered unto them. Verse 40 says, now when the sun was setting, all they that had any sick with divers diseases brought them unto him, still speaking of Christ, and he laid his hands on every one of them and healed them. Verse 41, and devils also came out of many, crying out and saying, thou art Christ, the Son of God. And he rebuking them, suffered them not to speak, for they knew that he was Christ. Did you hear that? It says, and devils all came out of many, crying out and saying, thou art Christ, the Son of God. And he rebuking them did not allow them to speak. That's what it means when it says suffered them not to speak, for they knew that he was Christ. So if we're just going to use the test of if the person confesses Christ, all right, if they are able to say that he's the Son of God, then that means that the spirit that is speaking in them is the Holy Spirit, and that the person has the Holy Spirit, and that the person is born of God, then that would mean that these devils have the Holy Spirit. All right, these people with devils have the Holy Spirit, or these people are the spirit that's speaking is the Holy Spirit. It's not. It plainly says here that it was the devil that was speaking, and the devil that was crying out, and the devil in them that was saying, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of God." And he rebuked them. Now, Christ is not going to rebuke the Holy Spirit. He rebuked this spirit, even though it was saying the truth. Listen, someone can have a demon and still proclaim what is the truth. We have to have discerning of spirits, which is the gift of discerning of spirits that is given to us by the Holy Spirit, which we cannot possess unless we have the Holy Spirit dwelling in us, to be able to discern between the Holy Spirit that is speaking through someone who is filled with the Holy Spirit, or a spirit that has been permitted to speak the truth, all right? Or a spirit that is just speaking the truth. And one of the ways that that spirit who has possessed someone who may not, and who is not born again, is one of the ways that they manifest themselves is by speaking the word of God. One minute they can be speaking the word of God, the next minute they could be manifesting in another form, multiple personality spirits. I have seen them over and over and over and over again. Am I looking for them? No. Most often they come looking for you. Let me tell you something. Let me show you something in Acts chapter 16. Okay, you know what? Before we even get there, this is an example. Let's stay in Luke chapter 4. I'm going to show you how spirits see you. Spirits get stirred up by your presence when you have the Holy Spirit. All right? Or when they feel that you are going to disturb them or expose their hiding. Okay? They are hiding. They love to hide, but they will run towards, or they will hang around, or they will constantly lurk around those that they feel threatened by. I have people who come to this channel over and over again, even without saying a word. Sometimes I can tell that they have been on this channel, and they will lurk around the channel because it's the spirit in them, all right, that is attracted to the word in a negative sense of the way, or attracted to you in a negative sense of the way, because they are threatened by the Spirit of Christ, not by you, but by the Spirit of Christ and by the Spirit of truth in you. It will happen if you are born of the Spirit of Christ. Listen, you don't have to go looking for their trouble. They will constantly come to you. Let me show you. Luke chapter 4, verse 31 says, "And came down to Capernaum, a city of Galilee." This is speaking about Christ and his disciples. "And taught them on the Sabbath days. And they were astonished at his doctrine, for his word was with power. And in the synagogue there was a man which had a spirit of an unclean devil, and cried out with a loud voice, saying, Let us alone. What have we to do with thee, thou Yeshua of Nazareth?" Now, what did Christ do to him? Absolutely nothing. He just showed up to teach on the Sabbath days. But there was a man which had a spirit of an unclean devil, and that spirit started to cry out. A lot of time when you are preaching the truth, you're ministering the truth, you're just living the life, spirits will begin to cry out to you. They may not say, "What have I to do with you, Bob? What do I have to do with you, Sally? What do I have to do with you, Rebecca? What do I have to do with you, Joe?" But their actions, their words towards you, their hatreds, their arrows of hatred that they constantly throw at you will always be their form of crying out against you. That's their way of saying, "What have I to do with you?" You haven't done anything to them. You're minding your own business. You're sharing the word of Yah. You're living your life. But your mere presence or your existence will always cause demons to be stirred up. Just face the facts. And not only will they cry out when you are present, they will sometimes run towards you. Let me show you that as well. Okay, I hope that you're still in here and holding on. All right, but we're going to show you, we're going to continue on in the word of Yah and show you that spirits will come seeking you. All right, and just because a person is speaking the truth does not mean that they have the Holy Spirit dwelling in them. But when we have the gift of the Holy Spirit, who gives us the gift of discerning of spirits, if we are gifted that way, or we can pray and ask for it and wait for him to give it to us with confirmation, okay, and with training, in the gift. All right. Just because you get one manifestation of it doesn't mean that you have the gift. It may just be one time that where he's revealing to you a certain spirit. The same thing as prophecy. That's why the scripture tells us to wait. All right. We have to learn to wait on our gifts. We have to learn for the wait for the Holy Spirit to perfect those things in us. All right. Verse 1 of Mark chapter 5 says, "And they came over unto the other side of the sea, into the country of the Gadareans," speaking of Christ and his disciples. "And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him." Did it say he came to meet them? It said no. "Immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit, who had his dwelling among the tombs, and no man could bind him, no, not with chains, because that he had been often bound with fetters and chains, and the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken in pieces. Neither could any man tame him. And always night and day he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. But when he saw Yeshua afar off," not even nearby, "afar off, he ran and worshiped him." Let's stop there. Christ just showed up. He just showed up. Now, I know that it was by the Holy Spirit that's in him. All right. He knew he needed to go there. He knew this man needed to be liberated. But just showing up without announcement to the people, without announcements to this man with the unclean spirit, as they called it, ran and met him out of the tombs. Okay. Now, not only did he run, he saw him from afar off and ran to him and began to worship. So if your test of telling whether someone has the spirit of Christ in them or not is because they recognize who Christ is, listen, demons recognize who Christ is. Demons recognize who we are as the children of Yah. Demons can proclaim that thou art the Christ, the Son of the living Yah. Demons can preach the truth. Demons can even worship. All right? And please know, they recognize you before you even see them. They spot you afar off. And they will come, and even if they don't say anything to you, they will always be around somewhere. Get that in your heart. Get that in your mind so that you can be aware and wise and be wise. All right. Verse 7 says, "And cried with a loud voice," speaking of the man with the evil spirits, "and said, What have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High Yah?" Now, who's speaking? Is it the man? No, these are the demons. Demons will always be disturbed at the coming of Christ. They will always be disturbed at the presence of Christ. They will always be threatened by the presence of Christ. They will always be threatened by him coming, because he knows, they know when he comes, liberation is going to come. Freedom is going to come. But Satan wants to keep us bound. Satan wants to keep us bound. But Christ has come to set the captive free. And when he sets us free, we are truly free indeed. Continuing on, "I adjure thee," meaning I beg you, I want you to swear to God. The demon is asking God to Yeshua to swear. "I adjure thee by God that thou torment me not." He's pleading with him. "For he said unto him, Come out of the man, thou unclean spirit. And he asked him, What is thy name? And he answered, saying, My name is Legion, for we are many. And he besought him much that he would not send him away out of the country." Demons love territories. Once they have staked their claim in a certain territory and you show up, they will not be at ease. Okay. Not only that, they love staying in a particular territory. They are very territorial. That's why when you go to certain regions, you may find that in certain nations, there's a lot of fornication. There is a lot of sexual sin, fornication, adultery, sodomy, incest, anything that deals with sexual sin, because that is the principality, that is the power that is ruling in that area, okay, and ruling in those people. For example, Jordan. You see in the country of Jordan, lovely country, lovely people, okay, for the most part. But there's a spirit of perversion in that country. You have people who testify of men who just, you know, masturbate in public when they see strange women from other countries or different places, or even some of the local women. Why? If you check the history of Jordan, you see that those are the descendants of Lot. The children of Lot came about how? By incest. See, things just don't happen. You have to check the principality, the spiritual atmosphere, the spiritual genetics, and the physical genetics of the people. Where did they come from? Who is their, who are their ancestors? Where did they descend from? And you will find that a lot of the things that people do are traced back generations and generations and generations. All right? Continuing on. So he was pleading not to be cast out of that country, okay? Verse 11 says, now there was nigh unto the mountains a great herd of swine feeding, and all the devils besought him, saying, send us into the swine, that we may enter into them. And forthwith Yeshua gave them leave, and the unclean spirits went out and entered into the swine, and the herd ran violently down the steep place into the sea. They were about 2,000 and were choked into the sea. Did you see that? 2,000 demons in the man that the people just thought had an unclean spirit. All the time he had 2,000 devils in him. 2,000 demons in him. Listen, you may think that you just have a little problem, or someone has a little problem, and you may not even know that you're hosting 2,000 demons, and these demons will manifest in multiple personalities. One of the personalities may just love the word of Yah. One of the personalities will probably just love to hear and sit and listen to a good sermon or minister a good sermon. All right, but at other times you see it manifesting in other ways. It happens. I've seen it online and offline. Okay, we have to make sure that we have the Holy Spirit and that he is in control, because we can all fall prey to unclean spirits. We can all fall prey to being used by Satan. Look at Peter. He was saying, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living Yah. In the next moment, he was telling Christ, no, you will not go to the cross and die. And Christ had to rebuke him and say, get thee hence, Satan. Not just Peter speaking something that's not right. Let's read it. Matthew chapter 16. All right, Matthew chapter 16. Let's see. We see here in verse 13 that Peter is confessing that Christ was the Son of the living Yah, here in verse 13 through 20. But when we continue on, it says here in verse 21, from that time forth began Jesus to show unto his disciples how he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed and be raised again the third day. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, be it far from thee, Lord, this shall not be unto thee. But he turned and said unto Peter, get thee behind me, Satan, thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men. He was speaking plainly to Peter, but he called the words that he was speaking, or he called him Satan. All right? It was Peter's body, but it was Satan that was speaking. And we have to realize that at times, Satan can easily speak through any one of us. But we have to yield ourselves to the correction of Christ. Now, they didn't have the Holy Spirit dwelling in them, but we have the Holy Spirit dwelling in us. And he's going to lead us and guide us into all truth. And he doesn't speak the things of himself, but of the Father. And we have to be willing to allow him to speak through us. And when he speaks to us and checks us, yield to that check. The Holy Spirit will always give us a witness. He'll always give us that little check in our spirit when we are wrong and when we are speaking in ourselves and not in him. All right? Let's continue on. I'm going to show you another example, and then I'm going to wrap this up, and we're going to go into some other things. And this is just part one, remember. All right, we're going to be speaking about how can we tell if the person has the Holy Spirit or if this is the Holy Spirit that's speaking through us. But how can we tell if someone is born of the Spirit of Christ and some other things that we'll cover, okay? Now, here's an example of someone who is declaring true, but it is not the Spirit of Christ that is speaking through them. This is an example of Paul and his fellow brethren in the Lord, disciples. Verse 16 of Acts chapter 16 says, "And it came to pass, as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with the spirit of divination," we've already done a share on this, the spirit of Python, all right, "met us, which brought her masters much gain by soothsaying. The same followed Paul and us and cried, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, which show unto us the way of salvation. And this did she many days. But Paul, being grieved, turned and said to the Spirit, I command thee in the name of Yeshua Christ, come out of her. And he came out the same hour." Did you hear that? She followed them for many days. She was saying what was right. She was in every church service. But listen, I want to show you something. It says here, "And it came to pass, as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with the spirit of divination met us." Remember, the Holy Spirit has already told us, demons will meet you. They recognize you. They see you. They will always be around you. They will. She came looking for them. She spotted them. And not only that, she followed them for many days. And for many days, she was declaring, these are the servants of the Most High God, which show unto us the way of salvation. Is that not the truth? It is the truth. But was it the Spirit of Christ speaking in her? Or was it an evil spirit that Paul and his disciples permitted to speak for many days? But when you are filled with the Holy Spirit, even though you will tolerate unclean spirits to speak for many days, there will come a time when you are just grieved beyond the limit that you can take, all right? Or the limit that the Holy Spirit is allowing you to take, and he will allow you to turn and rebuke that spirit for what it is and command it to come out. But listen, you cannot force spirits out of people. You have the power to cast it out, but they have to be willing to be delivered. It had to be something in this young lady that was willing to be delivered. You cannot cast out the spirit of Antichrist, as we read about in 1 John chapter 4. Listen, the spirit of Antichrist, once again, is a state of the mind and the heart. That spirit cannot be cast out. If that were the case, the Antichrist could be delivered from the spirit that is controlling him. He can't be delivered. He's doomed for destruction. He's the waster that has been created to destroy, all right, to be destroyed. But if a person has a demon, you can cast it out of them if they are willing to be delivered. Or you can get power over that demon. But power over Antichrist, we don't have. Only the Most High Yah has the power over the Antichrist, because it's determined by the person's will, all right? They have to be willing. Now, if a person has a demon that they are happy to abide with, they don't want to divorce that demon. They are happy to live with them. They say, you're not going anywhere. I'm happy for you to be here. Then you can pray all night. You can froth at the mouth. You can roll on the floor. You can tell them to hold on. And in the next second, you can tell them to let go. Unless they are willing to be free from that devil, is not going to come out. And the truth of the matter is, some people are happy with their demons.